The Ogre of Oglefort by Eva Ibbotson. Read by Alex Jennings. Most people are happier when their feet are dry. They do not care to hear squelchy noises in their shoes or feel water seeping between their toes. But the hag of the dribble was different. Having wet feet made her feel better. It reminded her of the dribble where she was born and had lived for the first 78 years of her life. And now she dipped her socks into the wash basin and made sure they were thoroughly soaked before she put them on her feet and went downstairs to make porridge for herself and her lodgers. The hag was glad to be busy. It helped her to cope with the terrible homesickness which attacked her each morning when she woke and saw the sooty brick wall of the house opposite instead of the wide sky and scudding clouds of the place where she had lived so long. It is not easy to describe a dribble. A dribble is not exactly a marsh, nor is it really a bog or a water meadow, but it's a bit like all of these. It is quiet and peaceful, and the damp air is soft. There are frogs and newts under your feet, and birds wheeling overhead, but often you do not see a human being for days on end. Hags live for a very long time, and she had expected to end her days there, but one day men had come with machines and had started to drain the dribble and turn it into a building site. So the hag had come to London, because she needed to find work. The work she found was running a boarding house for other unusual people like herself. Displaced witches, or exhausted wizards, or weary water sprites who had to do ordinary jobs because the time for magic seemed to be past. The kettle had just come on to boil when she heard a noise coming from the room on the first floor where the troll was getting out of bed, and then a roar of fury. Ulf Oakroot also felt homesick when he woke up, but his homesickness was not a damp, dreamy homesickness like the hag's. It was a wild and angry longing for the forests of northern Sweden, where he had been born. Trolls are fierce and hairy and extremely strong, and they love the woods in which they live. But when men had come with great saws and started to cut down the forests, destroying everything in their path, the troll's world had been destroyed too. Ulf had left his homeland and taken a ship to Great Britain and moved into the hag's boarding house. Now he worked as a hospital porter, and because he was so strong and didn't put up with any nonsense, the patients loved him. The hag and the troll were good friends, and by the time they had drunk 3 cups of tea, they felt better. After all, when so many unusual creatures were going through bad times, losing their homes, doing jobs they would never have thought of doing in the olden days, it was wrong to grumble. And life at 26 Whipple Road was really not too bad. The other lodgers at Whipple Road were sisters, Henkies, those fairies who limp and have hollow backs. They worked as dinner ladies in a school. There was also a man called Mr. Prendergast, an absolutely ordinary man without a trace of magic in his blood. He had been living in the house when the hag took it over, and he saw no reason to leave. They were all sitting round the kitchen table when the postman came with an exciting letter. It was an invitation to the summer meeting of unusual creatures, which was just a week away. Everyone was pleased. The summer meeting was important. It was there that they were told what the holiday task was going to be, and it was always something nice. Last year they had gone to the seaside at Southend to put the evil eye on a plague of jellyfish which was bothering holidaymakers, and they had spent a happy week in the Grand Hotel. The year before they had gone to Scotland to deal with a gang of cattle rustlers which was threatening a herd of Highland cows. The scenery had been quite beautiful, and everyone had come back feeling strong and well. It was always fun, the summer task. It meant that they met all the other unusual creatures like themselves and had a break from their daily lives.
"I'll go and tell Gladys," said the hag.
Because the hag was a kind of witch, she had a familiar, an animal that helped her with her magic. Gladys was a toad. She lived in the backyard under a stone, so now the hag went out to give Gladys the good news.
We're off to the meeting next week, Gladys, said the hag.
Gladys came out from under the stone. She came out very, very slowly. She opened one eye, then she shut it again, and said a single word.
Tired.
What do you mean, tired? Said the hag. I'm tired. Everyone's tired. They got tired in the war when their houses were bombed and food was rationed and all that, and they've been tired ever since. But we have to do our work.
Gladys turned her back on the hag and began to crawl towards her stone.
Are you telling me you aren't coming to the meeting? Cried the hag.
Gladys did not answer, but her back end looked obstinate.
But I can't go without a familiar. It's impossible.
The troll shook his head.
It's a bad business, he said. But it's no good forcing her. She was always a bad-tempered animal. Goodness knows what she might get up to if you dragged her to the meeting against her will.
But what am I going to do? Cried the hag.
Could you perhaps get another familiar? Suggested Mr. Prendergast. There's a whole week to go.
A week's nothing, cried the hag. Oh, nothing's gone right since I left the dribble.
But she was a brave person, and soon pulled herself together. And the next day, the hunt for a new familiar began. The hag's friends did their best to help. The fishmonger, whose mother had been a selkie, one of those people that is a seal by day and a human at night, offered her the pick of his fish. Not the dead fish on the slab, of course, but the live ones in a tank, which he kept for customers who liked their fish to be absolutely fresh.
There's a nice flounder there, he said.
But the hag was doubtful.
It's really kind of you, she said, but fish are so difficult to transport.
Two witches who worked as nannies wheeling babies through the park took her to Kensington Gardens because they had seen a tufted duck on the pond that they thought might be trained up to be magical. But it was sitting on a clutch of eggs and looking broody. And one thing that familiars never do is sit on nests and breed. The next day, the hag took a bus to Trafalgar Square, where she remembered having seen a pigeon with a mad gleam in its eyes. The square was absolutely crammed with pigeons in those days, but though she paced backwards and forwards among the birds for a whole hour, she couldn't find that particular bird again.
"We'd better try the zoo," said the troll.
So they took the bus to Regent's Park. There were lynxes and pumas and jaguars, but the hag knew that they would not be happy in Whipple Road. Not one of the creatures she saw really met her eye. The harpy eagles seemed to be half asleep. The serpents lay under their sun lamps and wouldn't move.
"Oh, what is the matter with the world?" cried the hag when she got home again. "When I was young, any animal would have been proud to serve a hag or a wizard or a witch."
They were sitting sadly at the kitchen table when there was a knock on the door, and Mrs. Brainsweller came to borrow some sugar.
"I've had so many funerals this week, I hardly know which way up I am," she said, "and it's made me all behind with the shopping."
Mrs. Brainsweller was a banshee, one of those tall, thin fays who wail when people die, and they are very much in demand at funerals.
"You look a bit down in the mouth," she said,
when the hag had fetched the sugar. So they told her what had happened. Mrs. Brainsweller said,
"Bri will make you a familiar. There's nothing he couldn't do if he tried."
Bri was the banshee's only son. He was a wizard, a small man with thin arms and legs and an absolutely enormous head almost entirely filled with brains. His name was Dr. Brian Brainsweller, and he had learnt spells for turning cows blue and spells for turning sausages into boxing gloves and spells for making scrambled eggs come out of people's ears. But he was not good at tying his shoelaces or putting on his pyjamas the right way round, and he would have eaten furniture polish if you put it before him on a plate. Fortunately, this didn't happen, because Dr. Brainsweller lived with his mother.
"What are you doing, Bri?"
she would cry as he came down to breakfast with both his legs in one trouser leg, or tried to go to bed in the bath. It was Mrs. Brainsweller who had seen to it that Brian took all his wizardry exams and stopped him when he wanted to do ordinary things like riding a bicycle or eating an ice cream, because she knew that if you want to get to the top in anything, you must work at it all the time. The Brainswellers lived 2 doors down from the hag's boarding house, and Brian had a workshop in the garden, where he spent the day boiling things and stirring things and shaking things. The wizard listened carefully while the hag and the troll explained what they wanted.
"Your mother thought you might make me a familiar," said the hag.
Dr. Brainsweller looked worried.
"Oh, dear," he said. "I tried once and, well, come and look."
He led them to a cupboard and pulled out a plate with something on it. It looked like a very troubled banana, which had died in its sleep. After that, the hag lost heart completely. When she got back to number 26, she put on her hat and smeared some white toothpaste onto her blue tooth and left the house. She wanted to put magic behind her and talk to someone who belonged to a different world, someone completely ordinary and friendly and young. The Riverdene Home for Children in Need was not a cheerful place. Everything about it was grey. The building, the scuffed piece of earth which passed for a garden, the walls that surrounded it. Even when the children were taken out, walking in line through the narrow streets, they saw nothing green or colourful. Although the war against Hitler had been over for years, the bomb craters were still there, and the people they met looked weary. Ivo had been in the home since he was a baby. He was not exactly unhappy, but he was desperately bored. He knew that on Monday lunch would be claggy grey mince with dumplings, and on Tuesday it would be mashed potato with the smallest sausage in the world, and on Wednesday it would be cheese pie. Ivo's parents had been killed in a car accident, and there seemed to be no one else to whom he belonged. It was at the back gate that Ivo liked to stand, looking out between the iron bars onto the narrow street. Sometimes people would stop and talk to him. Most of them only said a word or two, but there was one person who had become a friend. Ivo was always pleased when she came. She was someone who said things one did not expect, and he did not know anybody else like that. The hag did not have a grandson, but if she had had one, she thought, he would have been like Ivo, with a snub nose, a friendly smile, and intelligent hazel eyes. She had started by just saying hello to him on the way to the shops, but gradually she had stopped at the gate longer and longer, and they had begun to have some interesting conversations. Today, though, the hag said,
"I have had such bad news, Ivo. I have been betrayed by my toad."
"By Gladys?" said Ivo.
"But that's terrible.
You lived with her for years and years in the Dribble, didn't you?"
"Yes, I did. But now she won't do any more work. She says she's tired."
"I don't understand," he said. "I thought familiars served for life."
The hag stared at him. She had never actually told him that Gladys was a familiar, but she wasn't surprised that he had guessed. She had realised all along that he was a most unusual boy.
"They're supposed to. And it's such a bad time. There's a meeting of the London branch of all the people who are, well, not ordinary, and some of them show off like anything. If I go without a familiar, they'll despise me, I'm sure."
She sighed.
"I suppose I must give up all idea of going."
"Can't you find another familiar?" Ivo asked.
"I've been everywhere."
And she told him of all her disappointments. There was a long pause. Then,
"Why does it have to be an animal?" asked Ivo.
"Why can't a familiar be a person? They're just servants, aren't they? People that help a witch or a wizard."
The hag sighed.
"I don't know where I'd get hold of one. And they'd have to be trained. Though I suppose if it was just for the meeting... Oh, but it's too late now."
"I could be one," Ivo said eagerly. "I could be your familiar."
The hag stared at him.
"No, no, that would never do. You're a proper human being like Mr. Prendergast. You shouldn't get mixed up with people like us."
But Ivo was frowning.
"You seem to think that being a proper human is a good thing, but is it? If being a proper human means living here and knowing exactly what is going to happen every moment of the day, then maybe it's not so marvellous. Maybe I want to live a life that's exciting and dangerous, even if it's only for a little while."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.